Daily walking close to thee. Let it be, dear Lord, let it be.
I am going to begin Bible study now. The Lord has put on my heart for today, In God We Trust. And I've been struggling to really get before the Lord like I normally do. I don't know what it just, something's been trying to stand in my way, and a few things that I've been having to do at work are not typical things that I would do when I have to do things that I'm not used to doing at work, that kind of causes a block in my studies. I am blessed. Let me just clarify that my job, the job I do, was a blessing from God because it provides me ample time. Normally it provides me ample time to study while I work. But every once in a while, things come up that don't allow for that, and God expects me to make other time for Him, and I do my best to do that. So I don't want to waste you guys' time tonight. So let's get right into the Bible. I'm going to see if I can share my screen. And I believe I am. So we're going to just start reading in Isaiah 36. And I'm probably going to read this whole chapter. And then whatever the Lord puts on my heart, draws out of my mouth, that's what will happen tonight. Is really up to Him. If we just read Isaiah 36, then that's what it'll be, if that's what the Lord wants. So I'm just going to begin reading. In Isaiah 36, verse 1 reads, "Now it came to pass in the 14th year of King Hezekiah that Sennacherib, king of Assyria, came up against all the defensed cities of Judah and took them." So it took all the cities that surrounded Jerusalem. Hallelujah. "And the king of Assyria sent Rabshakeh from Lachish to Jerusalem unto King Hezekiah with a great army. And he stood by the conduit of the upper pool in the highway of the fuller's field. Then came forth unto him Eliakim, Hilkiah's son, which was over the house, and Shebna the scribe, and Joah, Asaph's son, the recorder. And Rabshakeh said unto them, Say ye now to Hezekiah, Thus saith the great king, the king of Assyria, What confidence is this wherein thou trustest? I sayest thou, but they are but vain words. I have counsel and strength for war. Now on whom dost thou trust that thou rebellest against me?" So immediately we have here the enemy coming before the people and declaring that they have power to destroy the people. And going to verse 6, "Lo, thou trustest in the staff of this broken reed on Egypt, whereon if a man lean, it will go into his hand and pierce it. So is Pharaoh, king of Egypt, to all that trust in him." So here's the enemy saying, who else are you going to put your trust in? They basically say, what are you putting your trust in? Then they say, here's an option of someone else you could put your trust in. And then he says, but if thou say to me, we trust in the Lord our God. So it went from what do you trust to here's someone you can trust. And then it gets to, but if you say you trust the Lord our God, is it not he whose high places and whose altars Hezekiah hath taken away and said to Judah and to Jerusalem, ye shall worship before this altar? And so here it's, if you're trusting in God, let me try to give you a reason to doubt. Hallelujah. And I'll probably come back to that verse, but I want to keep reading. Now, therefore, give pledges, I pray thee, to my master, the king of Assyria, and I will give thee 2,000 horses if thou be able on thy part to set riders upon them. How then wilt thou turn away the face of one captain of the least of my master's servants and put thy trust on Egypt for chariots and for horsemen? And am I now come up without the Lord against this land to destroy it? The Lord said unto me, go up against this land and destroy it. Then said Eliakim and Shebna and Joah unto Rabshakeh, speak, I pray thee, unto thy servants in the Syrian language, for we understand it, and we speak not, and speak not to us in the Jews' language, in the ears of the people that are on the wall. Hallelujah. But Rabshakeh said, hath my master sent me to thy master and to thee to speak these words? Hath he not sent me to the men that sit upon the wall, that they may eat their own dung and drink their own piss with you? Then Rabshakeh stood and cried with a loud voice in the Jews' language and said, hear ye the words of the great king, the king of Assyria. Thus saith the king, let not Hezekiah deceive you, for he shall not be able to deliver you. Neither let Hezekiah make you trust in the Lord, saying, the Lord will surely deliver us. This city shall not be delivered into the hand of the king of Assyria. Here again, trying to sway them from trusting God. Hearken not to Hezekiah, for thus saith the king of Assyria, make an agreement with me by a present, and come out to me, and eat ye every one of his vine, and every one of his fig tree, and drink ye every one the waters of his own cistern, until I come and take you away to a land like your own land, a land of corn and wine, a land of bread and vineyards. So he's saying, I'm going to take you to a place that's exactly like the place you're at right now. Well, if that's the case, I'd like to just stay where I am. Beware lest Hezekiah persuade you, saying, the Lord will deliver us. Hath any of the gods of the nations delivered his land out of the hand of the king of Assyria? Where are the gods of Hamath and Arphad? Where are the gods of Sepharvaim? And have they delivered Samaria out of my hand? Who are they among all the gods of these lands that have delivered their land out of my hand, that the Lord should deliver Jerusalem out of my hand? But they held their peace and answered him not a word, for the king's commandment was saying, answer him not. Then came Eliakim, the son of Hilkiah, that was over the household, and Shebna the scribe, and Joah, the son of Asaph, the recorder, to Hezekiah with their clothes rent, and told him the words of Rabshakeh. So this was a message from one king to another king. Hallelujah. And the king of Assyria was declaring that he was coming to take the people captive and to destroy Judah and Jerusalem. And we see in verse 7, if thou say to me, we trust in the Lord our God, is it not he whose high places and whose altars Hezekiah hath taken away and said to Judah and to Jerusalem, ye shall worship before this altar? Hallelujah. So they're trying to get the people to doubt God. Why would the enemy try to get God's people to doubt God? Because if the people of God doubt God, that makes the enemy's job that much easier. This is profound. It's not easy for us to not doubt God. But if we if we can walk by faith, then we automatically create a stumbling block for our enemies, not just for the devil, for all our enemies, for anyone that might come against us. If we're walking by the faith, right? And then this too, the enemy will lie, because here in verse 7, it says that Hezekiah took away the high places and the altars and said, you have to worship in one place. That is true. But he's saying that God was offended by that. Is it not he whose high places and whose altars Hezekiah had taken away and said to Judah and Jerusalem, you shall worship before this altar? He's saying that Hezekiah did that, and that was a wrongful act towards God. There, he's bearing false witness against Hezekiah, because as I understand it, Hezekiah actually took down the altars, took down the high places, because the people were worshiping God with pagan rituals in a manner that was very pagan. They were going to the high places and creating altars on those high places. And they were saying, the higher the place, the closer I am to God. But God said to Hezekiah, take away these high places, tear them down, tear down all the altars, and have them just worship only in Jerusalem. Only before my actual altar have the people worship me. And so this was actually an act. See, but the enemy will try to get us, because he's crafty. He'll try to tell us you can worship God in ways that are not being taught in the Christian church. You can worship God in ways that I guess basically make God your own. You can decide, right? Because sorry, I got distracted on my phone. Distractions coming from every turn today. You cannot believe in God in your own way. I remember before I got saved that somewhere along the line of my life, I was taught, I believe in God. I just believe in my own way. And that's false doctrine. You either believe what the Bible says, and you believe that God is God of the Bible, or you're believing in a different God. And that's the point of the title tonight, In God We Trust, because when this nation, I pulled it up, this nation adopted In God We Trust, and it was adopted as the official motto by the U.S. Congress. See, I thought it had been for a long time. I didn't realize it was so recent, but it was just in 1956, the U.S. Congress adopted In God We Trust as the official motto of the United States of America. Prior to that, it was E Pluribus Unum, meaning from many, one. And that was the official motto from 1776. But in 1956, we changed it. I did a little bit of research. It was actually changed because the Cold War, it was like a tactic, because the Soviet Union was atheist. And so basically, we decided we're going to make our motto, In God We Trust, as a tactic to declare to the world that we are God's nation. We are God's nation of people, and we will prevail. Hallelujah. And so that's when that was adopted. Prior to that, it was put on the 2-cent piece you see right here in 1864. That was during the Civil War. People thought that it needed to be added to the money, In God We Trust. And so they added it to the 2-cent piece, but it wasn't until Congress adopted it in 1956 that it was added to the rest of the money. And so, In God We Trust is actually a young motto for our nation. It's not a very seasoned motto, but the reason that we adopted it speaks volumes. Because that's what we should be declaring, not just as a nation, as a people, as individual people. We should be declaring, "In God I trust. In God I trust." And that's how we get the victory over everything. Because here we see the king of Assyria coming to chop down the land. And here we sit in the United States today. We don't even need kings from other nations to come destroy our land. We have kings in our own nation, kings of our own nation that are destined to destroy our land. Hallelujah. And I have to say, concerning Kamala Harris, prior to today, when I searched, I mean, a long time ago, back during the Democratic primaries of last year, when I searched, is she a Christian? What came up was that she's strongly rooted in her Christian roots, and she's also Hindu. How can you be Hindu and Christian? I tried to research that today. You can't find it today. Today, it's classified as fake news if I say that, but I'll tell you, I've seen it. Hallelujah. And you can't be both. And it's time for us to start voting with our convictions of God. It's time for us to start acting with the convictions that God gives us. Hallelujah. Because see, the world's trying to make it identity based on identity, what you see. Hallelujah. But God says we've got to be going based on what we feel from His Spirit. We got to be going, what honors God, not what honors us as people. And we've also got to trust, see, because right, let me see right here in verse 10. I now come up without the Lord against this land to destroy it. The Lord said unto me, go up against this land and destroy it. Look, the leaders will tell you, the Lord sent me. The Lord sent me. You got to believe me, even though they want to destroy us as people. And I'm not talking about either side now. I'm talking about all of them. Because some of them will go out of their way to protect Christians just so they can get a vote. But the other ones will claim to be Christians, hoping that they can sway the... None of them are actually Christians anymore. We don't have any leaders who are actually raising their hands and saying, "In God I trust." See, when that was put into place in 1956, the president, I believe it was, yeah, Dwight D. Eisenhower. Hallelujah. And this man went in front of all the people to say something, to give a little speech. And he's like, "Before I begin, I need to say a personal prayer, and I ask that all of you would bow your heads." Now, see, that was then. Now on the National Day of Prayer this year, we invited everyone from every different faith. Come on, let's all pray to our individual gods together. Which God do we trust? Because if it's any God that's not the God of the Bible, then we are not safe. We cannot find safety in that motto. If we're putting our trust in anything other than the God of the Bible, we're putting ourselves in harm's way. And we're subject to believe somebody when they say the Lord. And you see this right here, the Lord right here, all caps. That means this man used the Lord's name, Yahweh. The Lord called out God, said, "The same." He wanted to be sure. You all know I'm talking about the same God you're talking about. These politicians will say Jesus' name, and they'll act like they actually know him. In the very next breath, they'll spit on him. Then said, "Look, let me see. Yeah, the people of Judah, Eliakim and Shebna and Joah." They said to him, "Speak in a different language. Speak in the Syrian language. Because now that you've summoned God into this, now that you've claimed that you know our God, all the people that have been sitting here acting like you ain't even talking, they're all paying attention all of a sudden. And that's how it goes. When anyone wants to all of a sudden act as if they know God, people who actually do turn and they say, okay, because Jesus said you'll know them by their fruits. We're going to know if these people actually know God. People will know if you actually know God. That's why we have to be in the Word of God. Hallelujah. But right there in verse 15, that's where it really gets. Because look, some of the leaders, there are leaders, maybe not at the very top, but there are leaders out there who want us to trust in the Lord. If we can't find them in politics, we can find them in our churches. Our church has a leader that actually wants us to trust in the Lord. But the enemy will be real quick to say, neither let Pastor Bill make you trust in the Lord, saying the Lord will surely deliver us. The enemy will be real quick to tell you that. The enemy will be real quick to say, don't let Brother Russell make you trust in the Lord. The enemy will tell you, don't let your mom make you trust in the Lord. Don't let your kids make you trust in the Lord, saying the Lord will surely deliver you. Because the enemy wants you to think that you can't win. Hallelujah. So in God we trust. What God are we trusting? What God are we trusting when we say, in God I trust? Because let me just start reading 37. But we got to know which God we're actually worshiping. Especially because, look, we are closing in on the end times. This is hopefully just a message that someone could happen upon after the rapture's already taken place. Because I firmly believe that the Antichrist will not come to power until the rapture of the church has taken place. Glory to God. That's why the word says, comfort each other with these words. But for someone that's going to be there when the one world religion is coming together, they're going to all claim that they're worshiping the same God. But I'm telling you, if their God is not the God of the Bible, is not the same God you have, they could have their, I don't know how the Islamic faith works, but if it's up to Joe Biden, they'll start teaching it in schools. But they're going to tell you that their God, I don't know his name, Muhammad, Allah. Yeah, that's the one. Allah. They'll tell you that he's the God of the Bible, and he's not. God is the God of the Bible. Yahweh, Jesus, the Son of the God of the Bible. They're not all the same. So we got to know which one we're worshiping. And it came to pass when King Hezekiah heard it that he rent his clothes. So everyone ran to him, tearing their clothes. And he's like, yep, that makes me mad too. He tears his clothes off and covered himself with sackcloth and went into the house of the Lord. He was mourning. And he said, I want to know, was he mourning because his city was about to be destroyed? Or was he mourning because the enemy came in and so easily made all the people doubt God? And he sent Eliakim, who was over the household, and Shebna the scribe, and the elders of the priests, covered with sackcloth, unto Isaiah the prophet, the son of Amos. And they said unto him, thus saith Hezekiah, this day is a day of trouble, and of rebuke, and of blasphemy. For the children are come to the birth, and there is not strength to bring forth. See, this is where we can start finding peace. We have to identify the blasphemy. There is so much blasphemy happening these days. But although it troubles us, it makes us angry, it causes sometimes fear and worry. Ultimately, blasphemy against God, that's a dangerous sin. We don't even have to rebuke for that. God will rebuke for that. But see, it says the children are come to the birth and there's not strength to bring forth. Hallelujah. This God, when I read this today, God told me that is my church right now. I have brought them to the birth and they don't have the strength to push through. The church, I'm guilty too. I'm part of the church. I've been saying, Lord, bring revival. God, I want to see revival. God, send the people. But now we're actually, look, we're in a place where there's so much happening. People are realizing that they need God. That's what tribulation does. Tribulation opens a door for people to realize that they need God. And the church right now is so caught up in the mess that we don't have strength to bring forth. We're so downtrodden. We feel like the people, the government, the world has a boot on our neck. And we're just trying to hold on, right? We're wondering if we're going to be able to still open the doors next week. Not because of finances. Glory to God, he's taking care of that. But is there going to be a decree that says we're not allowed to gather in the church next week? We're wondering, are we still going to be able to declare our love for Jesus and actually have it an outwardly declaration? Or are we going to see the point soon where if we worship Jesus, we have to do that in secret? We're at a point where there's a birth, right? Jesus said the harvest is plentiful, the laborers are few. We're at the harvest. We're at the point of harvest, but we're so worn down from all the chaos that's ensuing. But let's see verse 4. It may be the Lord thy God will hear the words of Rabshakeh, whom the king of Assyria, his master, hath sent to reproach the living God, and will reprove the words which the Lord thy God hath heard. Wherefore, lift up thy prayer for the remnant that is left. See, it may be that God heard the blasphemy that was taking place. It may be that God heard the enemy trying to tell you not to trust God. It may be that God was a witness to the abuse that you've been putting up with. It may be that God saw the hurt and the pain that you've been dealing with. It may be that God saw all the tribulation you've been met with. It may be that God has been watching this whole time, these enemies coming against you left and right, and now all of a sudden, he may do something about it, but we got to lift up the prayer for the remnant that is left. Whatever's left, we got to ask God to salvage it. So the servants of King Hezekiah came to Isaiah. They went to the man of God, and Isaiah said unto them, thus shall ye say unto your master, thus saith the Lord, be not afraid of the words that thou hast heard, wherewith the servants of the king of Assyria have blasphemed me. Don't worry about anything. If the enemy insults God while he's trying to cast fear into you, he has a problem, not you. Behold, I will send a blast upon him. Hallelujah. God said, I will send a blast upon him. The one that's been coming against you. Hallelujah. God's going to send a blast, and he shall hear a rumor and return to his own land. And I will cause him to fall by the sword in his own land. Y'all don't even have to take care of him. We don't have to take care of the politicians that want to support homosexuality. We don't have to handle them. God will. We don't have to do anything. We just gotta look. We gotta lift up thy prayer for the remnant that is left. That's what we gotta do. That should have been the title for tonight. Lift up thy prayer for the remnant that is left. Hallelujah. Behold, I will send a blast upon him, and he shall hear a rumor and return to his own land, and I will cause him to fall by the sword in his own land. He's going to die at home. One of his own's going to take him out. Let the evil eat out the evil. So Rabshakeh returned and found the king of Assyria warring against Libna, for he had heard that he was departed from Lachish, and he heard say concerning Tiraka, king of Ethiopia, he has come forth to make war with thee. And when he heard it, he sent messengers to Hezekiah, saying, thus shall ye speak to Hezekiah, king of Judah, saying, let not thy God in whom thou trustest deceive thee. Now he's saying, don't let God deceive you, saying, Jerusalem shall not be given into the hand of the king of Assyria. So now the king of Assyria is trying to say, even what God said doesn't outdo what I'm saying. And see, this is where we got. Look, after that, the In God We Trust motto was put into law, all of a sudden we're declare that we trust in God, but then we take prayer and Bibles out of schools. Not long after that. I have to look at the dates, but as I understand, it was not long after. And likewise, the abortion law, all of a sudden you're allowed to have abortions. Which God are we trusting in? If all of a sudden we have no desire for our kids to read the Bible, we have no desire for our teachers to pray with our kids, and all of a sudden we want to just kill our kids altogether, which God are we trusting in? It's not the God of the Bible. But that's what the world's telling us. Don't let God deceive you. Don't let God deceive you. You're going to be sucked in no matter what. Got us to the point where it's like, well, maybe we should go that way so things can start to feel a little normal again. Or maybe we should stay over here and maybe they'll start to get normal again. But really, ultimately, it's go to Jesus and things can be normal again. If this nation would turn back to God, things could get back to normal. Because as we knew normal as a Christian nation. We're not a Christian nation anymore. If we want to get back to normal, we got to get back to God. In God we trust. Behold, thou hast heard what the kings of Assyria have done to all lands by destroying them utterly, and shalt thou be delivered? See, then they'll start to tell you, God didn't deliver that person. God didn't deliver, your God didn't, that that person. But look, they all have different gods. Everyone has different gods. People that aren't Christians have different gods. And then they want to look and say, look, their gods can't do it. What's so good about your God? What's so good about my God is that my God died for me. The only God that is known to man that died for man, for human, let me be politically correct, for men and women. God died so that we could be saved. The only God, Jesus Christ, the Messiah, the only one. Every other God did not die, and nor would they die. Why? Because they don't exist. Our God is real. Have the gods of the nations delivered them, which my fathers have destroyed? Look, me and my dad and my grandpa, we all destroyed a whole bunch of people, and there was no God that could stop us. That's what he's saying. And that's really where our, Lord, help us. That's where our nation is. We've destroyed a whole bunch of things, and there's no God that could stop us. Hallelujah. But there is. And Hezekiah, where is the king of Hamath and the king of Arphad and the king of the city of Sepharvaim, Hena and Iva? Here we go again, giving the list again. And Hezekiah received the letter from the hand of the messengers and read it. And Hezekiah went up unto the house of the Lord and spread it before the Lord. See, Hezekiah got the list. Glory to God, he got the list, and he took it, and he went, and he laid it out before God, and he said, God, this is the list.
they're saying that they destroyed all these places and that no God could stop them. Hallelujah. This is what we got. Look, I think I heard Sister Regina before say, when I get a new bill, I take it and I lay it before the Lord. When you get an unexpected bill in the mail, take it, lay it before the Lord. Say, Lord, not my problem, your problem now. Hallelujah. That's what God wants. Obviously, maybe be a little more reverential. Don't say, not my problem, yours. But say, God, I got this problem. It's freaking me out. And I need help with it, God. Actually, lay it before him. And this is what I love about this right here in verse 14, is that he physically spread it before the Lord. It's not like he just read it, knew what it said in it, and then went, put it down, went to the prayer room. He went to the prayer room with it, and he opened it up and said, God, look at this. Look at this problem that I have. Won't you fix it, please? This goes for our health. This goes for our finances. This goes for salvation for us and for our children. This goes for when we can't stop lusting. This goes for when we can't put down our phone or we can't pick it up and actually open up the Bible app. It's God wants us to lay it before him and say, God, help me with this. Help me with this problem. It's real. Let me show it to you. That's part of confession. God's been working with me on confession. I have a hard time actually confessing before the Lord and saying, God, this is what I need help with. This exact things, because I'll be beating around the bush with God like he don't know what I'm talking about anyway. And I'll be like, God, you know that one thing. Yeah, I need to know what you think about that. And then God's like, tell me what it is. Because you need to be open and honest with God. You need to spread your problems before the Lord. And Hezekiah prayed unto the Lord, saying, O Lord of hosts, God of Israel, that dwellest between the cherubims, thou art the God, even thou alone, of all the kingdoms of the earth. Thou hast made heaven and earth. See, Hezekiah knew what God he trusted in. He said, God of Israel, thou art the God, even thou alone. He said, let me be clear. You're the only one. Thou hast made heaven and earth. Incline thine ear, O Lord, and hear. Open thine eyes, O Lord, and see and hear all the words of Sennacherib, which has sent to reproach the living God. See, because that's it right there. He's like, Lord, this is not my problem. It's your problem, God. See, he says it right there, which has sent to reproach the living God. God, it looks like all these things are happening to me, but actually they're happening to you. God, of a truth, Lord, the kings of Assyria have laid waste all the nations and their countries. Look, Lord, they're destroying everything. Everything is being destroyed of a truth. And have cast their gods into the fire, for they were no gods, but the work of men's hands, wood and stone. Therefore, they have destroyed them. See, so he's saying, God, they were able to destroy those other gods because they were not you. They were not a real, living, breathing God in heaven. Now, therefore, O Lord, our God, save us from his hand, that all the kingdoms of the earth may know that thou art the Lord, even thou only. Hallelujah. Mic drop right there. Therefore, O Lord, our God, save us from his hand. Hallelujah. Lord, our God, save us from our government's hand. Save us from the hand of everyone that has gained leadership in this nation. Hallelujah. Why? So that all the kingdoms of the earth may know that you alone are God, only you. God, I don't want to live in the world as constituted. God,
I desperately don't want my kids to live in the world as constituted. But God, more important than any of that is this world has got to know who you are. So God, work a miracle over the situation that we're in. Lord, so that everyone will glorify you, so that you will be glorified in the earth. Then Isaiah, the son of Amos, sent unto Hezekiah, saying, thus saith the Lord God of Israel, whereas thou hast prayed to me against Sennacherib, king of Assyria. See, God says, I heard your prayer. This is the word which the Lord has spoken concerning him. The virgin, the daughter of Zion, hath despised thee. This is the word which the Lord has spoken concerning Sennacherib. The virgin, the daughter of Zion, hath despised thee and laughed thee to scorn. The daughter of Jerusalem hath shaken her head at thee. See, you were saying that you were going to take her. You were saying that you were going to have her with ease. You were saying that she would jump into the palm of your hand. But instead, she hates you. Hallelujah. She laughs at you, and she's shaking her head, saying, no, you can't have it. I'm not yours. Hallelujah. See, because in 36, the word of Hezekiah to the people was, do not respond. Even as the man was questioning their faith, even as the man was calling out their king, their command was, do not respond. See, don't respond to the enemy. Hezekiah didn't respond to the enemy. He went before the Lord. He took the letter before the Lord. He spread it before the Lord. He said, this is what the enemy is doing to me. Hallelujah. He didn't say, Satan, get thee behind me. Jesus said, get thee behind me, but he's God. It made a big difference for Jesus to tell Satan, get thee behind me. It don't make a big difference for us to say, Satan, get thee behind me. Hallelujah. It makes a big difference for us to go before the Lord, take the problems that were being dealt and handed, and say, God, these are my problems. Now will you fix them? And then God will make your enemy feel stupid. God will tell the enemy, look, this is what God did. He told the enemy, Brother Russell has despised you and laughed thee to scorn. Brother Russell has shaken his head at thee. That hurts a lot more coming from the lips of God than it coming from my lips. We got to let God speak for us. Whom hast thou reproached and blasphemed? See, and then it gets better. He's like, well, now that I told you how my beloved feels, let me go on and tell you what you really did wrong. Whom hast thou reproached and blasphemed? And against whom hast thou exalted thy voice and lifted up thine eyes on high? Even against the Holy One of Israel. By thy servants hast thou reproached the Lord and hast said, by the multitude of my chariots am I come up to the height of the mountains, to the sides of Lebanon, and I will cut down the tall cedars thereof and the choice fir trees thereof, and I will enter into the height of his border and the forest of his Carmel. I have digged and drunk water, and with the sole of my feet have I dried up all the rivers of the besieged places. Hast thou not heard long ago how I have done it? And of ancient times that I have formed it, now have I brought it to pass that thou shouldest be to lay waste defensed cities into ruinous heaps. Everything you did was because I allowed it. The enemy can't do nothing without God's permission. Therefore, their inhabitants were of small power. They were dismayed and confounded. They were as the grass of the field and as the green herb, as the grass on the housetops and as corn blasted before it be grown up. But I know thy abode and thy going out and thy coming in and thy rage against me. Because thy rage against me and thy tumult is come up into mine ears. Therefore will I put my hook in thy nose and my bridle in thy lips,
and I will turn thee back by the way by which thou camest. I'm going to send the enemy back the same way that they came. The path that they traveled down to get to you, they have to travel back to get back where they came from. And that's a sad truth for some people. I think of a saying that I heard a long time ago, be careful who you offend on your way up, because you're going to pass by the same people on your way back down. It's, you have to go back the same way you came. If you've been denying God, hallelujah, that same path that you traveled down to get farther and farther away from God, you're going to have to travel that same path backwards to get back to him. And this shall be a sign unto thee, ye shall eat this year such as groweth of itself, and the second year that which springeth of the same, and in the third year sow ye, and reap, and plant vineyards, and eat the fruit thereof. And the remnant that is escaped of the house of Judah shall again take root downward and bear fruit upward. For out of Jerusalem shall go forth a remnant, and they that escape out of Mount Zion, the zeal of the Lord of hosts, shall do this. Therefore, thus saith the Lord concerning the king of Assyria, he shall not come into this city, nor shoot an arrow there, nor come before it with shields, nor cast a bank against it. By the way that he came, by the same shall he return, and shall not come into this city, saith the Lord. For I, hallelujah, God will defend this city to save it for mine own sake, and for my servant David's sake. Who was David? He was a man after God's own heart. God will defend you for his sake, but he'll defend you for your sake too if you are a person after God's own heart. See, because what God did in God We Trust, what God did was allow the king of Assyria to destroy every false god. Every false god in the area surrounding Judah was destroyed. But when it came time for the king of Assyria to try to destroy the one true and living God, God said, nope, I let you destroy all that because that needed to be destroyed. Thank you very much. You did my will. Hallelujah. Now that you did my will, you have the option of repenting. Turn around and go back the way you came. Hallelujah. That's repentance. Turn around and go back the way you came. Then the angel of the Lord went forth and smote in the camp of the Assyrians 185,000. And when they arose early in the morning, behold, they were all dead corpses. So Sennacherib, king of Assyria, departed and went and returned and dwelt at Nineveh, of all places, Nineveh. Go figure. Maybe he did repent. And it came to pass, as he was worshiping in the house of Nisroch, his god. See, he didn't. That Adrammelech and Sharezer, his sons, smote him with the sword, and they escaped into the land of Armenia. And Esarhaddon, his son, reigned in his stead. He had the chance to give it back to God. Hallelujah. We've had so many chances to give it back to God. And look, I include myself in this. I've had to give it back to God many times. I've had to travel down the road. Hallelujah. And I'm talking recently even, where I had to hear from God and God had to say, turn around. Same path you took, go back the other way. And that's how you get back to him. I'm not trying, I don't know who all is on here, and I'm closing on this, but this isn't necessarily saying you need to repent. I don't know your situation. God does. If you do need to repent, do it. But in the future, remember,
remember this, because the enemy will come in and try to tell you, don't let no one tell you to trust God. The enemy will come in and try to tell you, you're going to be destroyed. The enemy will try to come in and tell you that there's no hope for you if you find that you've started to stray from God. But ultimately, it's as simple as what God says. That's turn around, take the same path you took to get away from me, take it right straight back to me, and let's keep this thing going. And that's what we really got to be doing. Look, it really is that simple. And it would be that simple for our nation too, but not without the Spirit of the Lord. The Spirit of the Lord has to lead us and guide us. The Spirit of the Lord has to draw us into that state of repentance. It would be great if we could just convince each other to repent, but it has to be God. And unfortunately, we're in a place and a time where people really just aren't interested in hearing the voice of God, at least the God of the Bible. The world will tell you that they know the Lord, but you watch them and you'll know whether they actually believe in God of the Bible, in Jesus Christ as the Messiah, or if they're just saying look, this enemy did it. This servant of the king of Assyria, Rabshakeh, he did it. He said, the Lord sent me. So we got to just be careful. Just watch, be mindful of people saying, the Lord sent me, because the Lord's not sending everybody. And sometimes, look, the Lord did use the king of Assyria to take out and Rabshakeh to take out all the other false gods, all the false gods. So he did send them to do that, or he did at very least allowed them to do it. But there's a difference between those that are lusting after the flesh and lusting after the spirit. There's a difference between those who are truly serving God and those who are just showing up and sitting in the pew on Sunday. Granted, now I think for the most part, the people that are showing up in the pews on Sunday are the ones that are devoted to God fully. But that would be another sermon. Another Bible study. I'm going to just stop right now. Pastor Bill, if you would like to come on and make any comments, I am open to hearing them. And or if anyone has any comments or questions.
Oh, that was wonderful. And it was a great word, especially, you know, what caught my attention was in 37, I think it was chapter 37 and 3, uh-huh, where you had mentioned, I think it was 3, maybe it was 37 and, 3, where it said, he said unto him, thus said Hezekiah, this day is a day of trouble and of rebuke and of blasphemy. Mm-hmm. For the children are come to birth, and there's not enough strength to bring forth, you know. And even in the New Living Translation, it says, they told him, this is what King Hezekiah said, today is a day of trouble, insults, and disgrace. It's like when a child is ready to be born, but the mother has no strength to deliver the baby. You know, that baby, or if you want to even look at it this way, that fruit is in trouble. Mm-hmm. That fruit, ooh, is subject to die, whether it's love or joy or peace or long-suffering and gentleness or meekness or temperance or faith. And God has placed that seed of to grow inside of you, and because of you know, the aggressiveness of the enemy that has come to attack us. And he does it in subtle ways too, you know. That's one of the things I'm studying this week is aggression, you know. And there's different kinds of aggression. When I'm just wanted to mention this to you too. There's passive aggression and indirect aggression. You know, there's not just direct aggression. There was just one thing that, you know, in one of my papers that I wrote today about how in psychology, they say that sometimes when you're aggressively driving, you can indirectly be aggressive towards someone if you're aggressively driving and you crash into somebody. Well, that was aggression against that individual indirectly. Now, you may not have meant to do that, but sometimes, you know, there are things that are done towards us and it hurts us, or it and people aren't necessarily trying to do it, but because of how the enemy has come in so subtly, you know, even into the church, even families or marriages with households, the enemy has crept in there and indirectly just caused these. And what it says there is a day of trouble and insults and disgraces, that it has caused such a lack of strength that you can't even birth forth the fruit of the Spirit being manifest. You just want to throw up your hands and just, you know, go in a corner.
Yeah.
You know? And so it's amazing. But we listen, and one of the things I appreciate is that how we have to trust what you were saying. We have to trust in God with everything. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Especially when it comes for our deliverance and when it comes for our strength. All of our strength, all of our help comes from the Lord. Yeah. And when it comes to God delivering us, God has to help us even deliver the baby, even deliver our fruit, because we don't have the strength to do that in and of ourselves.
Amen.
Because what happens with us is again, when people offend us, we want to segregate ourselves. We want to separate. I just want to get away from it. I wish the Lord would just we can just leave. We want to separate ourselves.
Yeah.
That's not what Jesus did. When Jesus was offended, he went to him. And he dealt with that offense.
Yes.
He dealt with that offense. Because think about this. If you go to, and you don't have to go there, but I'm almost done, but if you go to the 17th chapter of Luke, when Jesus was passing, 17:11. Go to 17:11. It says, and Jesus continued towards Jerusalem to reach the border between Galilee and Samaria. He entered a village. See, he traveled places that we don't want to go to. We don't like to go to this out of the way places that people don't like to talk about, you know, things that are areas of our heart that we just don't want to deal with. God deals with them because they're areas that sometimes the light needs to be shined on. But he dealt with lepers that no one else wanted to deal with them, you know.
Yeah.
And sometimes what we don't want to deal with, God will deal with it. God will deal with unforgiveness, how we can't deal with it because we don't have the strength to deal with unforgiveness. So God has to help us to forgive because we don't have the strength to forgive. We don't have the strength, you know. It's him that does that. He's the one that has delivered us. And so the only thing, because they were – here, you know, these lepers were so out of the way that they were segregated, right?
Yeah.
They were put, like, no one wanted to deal with them. They didn't have any way of commerce. They didn't have a way of taking care of themselves. They were, they stood afar off in the distance, and they cried out, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. And the only thing he said is, go show yourself to the priest. See, in other words, God was saying, if you have the faith to re-identify yourself, glory to God.
Hallelujah.
If you have the faith to re-identify yourself with who, not who man says you are, but who I say you are, go show yourself to the priest. And the Bible said, as they went, they were cleansed. That's how God delivers us. It's trusting in him. See, it's trusting in God to deliver us. Amen. God delivers. God saves. He sets free as you go, as you trust him. See, it's more than just saying, yeah, I trust him. I believe him. Okay, I hear what you're saying. No. As they went, they were cleansed.
Amen.
So that's a good word. I appreciate you.
That's a good word. As they went, they were cleansed.
Yes, sir. Hallelujah. When you're trusting in God, you gotta take it. You gotta walk with him. You know, You gotta walk with him. So, amen. I appreciate the word. Thank you so much. I'm gonna give it back to you.
Okay. Are there any other comments? Any prayer requests? All right, let us pray our way out. Hallelujah. Heavenly Father, we just thank you once again for your word. Lord, without your word, we would not be able to get through these days, God. We're just so thankful for your word that leads us, guides us. We're so thankful for you making your word available to us always. Father, we're so thankful to you for making yourself available to us always. Lord, lead us to an even richer prayer life, God. Lead us to an even richer Bible reading habit, God. Lead us closer to you, Lord. Draw us to you in these times that we find ourselves in, Lord, not just in our nation, but in each of our individual lives, Lord. We all have things that we could do well to deal with closer to you. Father, we're just so thankful that you've joined us tonight, God. Thank you for every person that took the time out to come and fellowship on this Bible study tonight. God, I ask that you send a special blessing to each of them. And Father, again, we just praise you and we thank you, Lord, for your good and perfect will that's being done with Roy and Auntie Becky, God. And we just love you so much. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. God bless you all.
Are we going
out now? Huh? Uh-oh. Are we going out now? Daily walking close to let it be, dear Lord, let it be.